welcome.
Hello, so my name is Bahia Khan, and I'm from South Africa. And that's me back when I had dyed hair. Anyway, this is me now with my natural hair. Looks a bit fucked because bleach on dark hair, that's like self-harm. Anyway, so my talk is called Emos in Africa, a game developer's postmortem. And you see that like question mark is like, what the fuck is a game developer, right? Anyway, so who am I? I said Bahia Khan God, it's like, I keep mentioning that. But yeah, that's my handle on Twitter. And I'm Muslim and I'm from South Africa. Please tell me that you guys get that I don't like AF for African, because like South African is fuck. Anyway, yeah, so I made some games. One of the games that I made is what resulted in me being here today. It's called After Hours and it's an FMV game. I don't know if you heard about it, probably not, because like I'm not famous at all. sorry, sometimes I find myself funny and then I laugh and then the talk lags a bit. But anyway, yeah, so After Hours, it's this FMV game. For those of you who don't know what FMV is, it's a full motion video game. Also, I can speak really fast, so if I'm speaking too fast, just like do this and then I'll slow down, okay? Okay, yeah, so it's a full motion video game and it's about this young woman called Lilith Gray who was sexually abused as a child, and she sort of represses that, but because of that repression and the childhood trauma, she develops borderline personality disorder. And I made that game because I felt like people weren't speaking about it enough, at least not in the way that I felt was very helpful. Like, there were hashtags on Twitter, and I mean, okay, that did help some people, but for my friends and I, we wanted people to speak about it in a way where they sort of became more empathetic to understanding what was happening. Ooh, that's romantic, the light just went on. Okay, so yeah, I said I made some games. The other games that I made is called Fuck the System, War and Pieces, and some other really bad games that I'm not gonna speak about. I was actually just like, when I woke up this morning, I was thinking about this game that I made in my second year at varsity. So I'm in my fifth year now because I'm doing my master's. And I made it about, it was called Arizona, and it was about this guy who had a crush on a girl, but she was really depressed, so he went into her head and like fought her inner demons. And now when I think about it, I'm just like, what the fuck, yuck. I do not want to like amplify some like knight in shining armor. I want the girl to be the knight in shining armor, you know? I don't want it to be some fucking guy. And it was a white boy that I was thinking about when I made the game, so. Anyway, yeah, so I also write. I won't be shading any of that, though, ever, probably. And then sometimes I pretend to be in a band because I think that's really cool, and I'm working hard to become, like, my own dream boy, and my dream boy plays in a punk band. And then the last part, if it confuses you, very good, because that's how I feel as well. Earth, what the fuck is that, right? Okay, so before I continue about, like, emos and games and stuff, I'm just gonna go through some definitions. What does emo mean? Does anyone know? Am I like the only person stuck in 2005? Please raise your hand if you know what it is. If you feel that way at all, geez, this is exactly my crowd, okay. So yeah, I'm just gonna go to the last part where it says, a young person who likes this kind of music, wears mainly black clothes, and is often nervous, worried, and unhappy. Wow, that's me, the Holy Trinity, nervous, worried, unhappy. So yeah, I feel like when the whole like emo scene just came out for my generation, it started off being mainly like an aesthetic thing, and we'd listen to like a lot of pop punk and be like, oh, I fucking hate my parents, all of these things, whatever. But it stayed, surprise, it's not a phase, mom. And yeah, it's not just about like aesthetics anymore. It's about the way you feel. And I feel like, oh my God, I feel like I sound super pretentious saying all of these things. But yeah, anyway, that's kind of what emo is. On to the next definition. Postmortem. An examination or autopsy, an examination of a corpse in order to determine cause of death. So that's what a postmortem is. And I know that games often do postmortems, and I think that's cool. You know, it makes us realize what not to do, what to do, stuff like that. And I often feel like I'm just hanging, I'm not standing comfortably at all. Okay, I feel like for myself, and maybe other people feel like this as well, that when we make games, it's almost like playing God in a way. And then sometimes you fuck up your characters and you're like, oh shit, this is what not to do for the next time. And then you get another chance at it. So that's kind of what like postmortems are for me. But it's also, you know, when people actually die in real life and then you look at their bodies to determine the cause of death. And that's what I'm going to be speaking about. So video games, it's been said many times, but they are bad. Right? And I don't just mean like the act of playing video games, I mean like making video games. When I started making games, I don't count my first year of varsity because it was bad, worse than worse, just not good. And I count it sort of more from like my second year, so this will be my fourth year in video games. And when I started making it, I wasn't sure if I had a place in it because there was a very specific like narrative of what a game designer was, or at least I thought that, and I didn't feel like I fit in at all, you know? And then I read this book called Everything is Illuminated. Do you guys know that book? Okay, very good. And there's this quote from the book which made me think about why I make video games, right? Because it feels like, and there's this poem called Beasts Bounding Through Time by Charles Bukowski. And he mentions, do you guys know Charles Bukowski? Does anyone know that poem? And in that poem he speaks about a bunch of like authors who, like Dostoevsky, for instance, who has lined up to be shot by the government, and he speaks about authors that have killed themselves, suffered from mental illnesses. But by the end of everything, he still praises them because they did it. Not that they killed themselves, he's not praising that at all, just to clarify, but I mean that they did it in that they wrote something, they produced something that changed people's lives. And it might not have touched a lot of people, but if it touched anyone at all, you're making a difference. Oh my God, I don't want my mascara to run. So I'll be pulling a lot of ugly faces so I don't cry. It's super sexy. So he praises all of these authors and artists because they actually went out and did it. And that's how I feel about games, you know, that like, it's something at least. It might not be a massive thing, but you know, there was this kid in first year at my university who played my game after hours, and she thanked me for making it because she felt super alone and fucked up in like being molested as a child, and she felt alienated from everyone else. But she realized that actually, I'm not alone. And as lame and cliche as that might sound, there's often truths to cliche. That's how they become cliches, you know, through overusage. So I'm gonna go back to what I was saying of everything is illuminated and read a quote from that book. It's a bit long, so I'll read it out loud here and speak again about why I was making games before they like killed me. Okay, so this is how it goes. He awoke each morning with a desire to do right, to be a good and meaningful person, to be as simple as it sounded and as impossible as it actually was, happy. And during the course of each day, his heart would descend from his chest into his stomach. By early afternoon, he was overcome by the feeling that nothing was right, or nothing was right for him, and by the desire to be alone. By evening, he was fulfilled, alone in the magnitude of his grief, alone in his aimless guilt, alone even in his loneliness. I am not sad, he would repeat to himself over and over. I am not sad, as if he might one day convince himself, or fool himself, or convince others. The only thing worse than being sad is for others to know that you are sad. I am not sad, I am not sad. Because his life had unlimited potential for happiness, insofar as it was an empty white room. He would fall asleep with his heart at the foot of his bed, like some domesticated animal that was no part of him at all. And each morning he would wake with it again in the cupboard of his rib cage, having become a little heavier, a little weaker, but still pumping, And by the mid-afternoon, he was again overcome with a desire to be somewhere else. Someone else. Someone else somewhere else. I am not sad. So how does this tie into making video games? I feel like this every day. And when I make games, I feel like I'm doing something that it doesn't make it worth it, because I don't think fucking anything is worth feeling like this. And I don't ever want to romanticize feeling extremely awful, because it's not a romantic thing. It's disgusting and awful and super evil. And if you've ever felt like that, you know what I'm talking about, right? So that's why I made games. And I thought, like, you know, we often tell stories to make sense of the world, and maybe I can help someone else through this. But the thing about helping other people is that you need to be okay within yourself, or you'll just be like further infecting people, I feel. At least that's how, like, I see myself. And yeah, so that's why I was making games, right, to tell stories, because it felt good helping other people. And because, like, speaking to other people, I really like doing that when they aren't the worst. And just like kind of sharing stories and learning who they are. And so something that I do is I tutor game design at my university. And I don't just tutor that, I tutor language support for people that don't speak English as a first language. So I get to interact with quite like a large number of people from many different races and class backgrounds. And if you know anything about South Africa, you know that we are pretty diverse, but also still very racially divided and suffering from the legacy of apartheid and stuff like that. And with the kids that I teach, I see that. You know, most of the kids that I teach in language support are Black underprivileged students, and it's really, really difficult just seeing how much they have to go through to level the playing field. And yeah, anyway, I just on a side note, my talk is inherently about representation and South Africa, as it will always be, because I am here representing South Africa, right? And I'm also a woman of color doing this. So if there's any young girls at home, or old girls, anything really at home just watching this, like, oh my God, I feel like Shia LaBeouf, you can do it, you know, kind of thing. But seriously, you probably can if you have access to a lot of resources. There's always that big if, because like, if I didn't have access to the internet at university, I wouldn't have access to internet at all. And then I wouldn't hear about things like Train Jam or GDC, you know, stuff like that. But anyway, yeah, back to why I was making games. It's also about the community. And it's not about the community that I found specifically within video games. It's because I make games and people find that interesting. So that's the community that I'm speaking about. The people that find what I do interesting and come and speak to me about it. Like my students, some of them who happen to be first year game development students. And yeah, like, there's, just to give you an example of people and community. Before I left for to come to Berlin, one of my students, a young Black girl, came to me, and I actually tweeted about this, where she said that, so before I came to Berlin, I went to Train Jam for a while, so I didn't see my students for like 3 weeks, and then I came back, and she said, but yeah, I couldn't wait for you to come back, because I'm so unhappy here. And I said, like, what's wrong? And she said, well, we got put into groups randomly, and I'm in a group that's full of boys, and they are always speaking over me whenever I speak, and I feel extremely stupid, and like, I don't want to say anything, you know. And she said, and English isn't her first language as well, and she said, it's not that I don't feel comfortable speaking in English, I just feel like the content of what I have to say isn't enough. Like, she doesn't come from a private school like a lot of people often do at my university, and stuff like that. And then she said, I didn't tell anyone about it. I wanted to speak to you specifically because I want to be brave like you are. And I thought, what? Oh God, I'm not brave at all. I'm fucking terrified of everything. So, I mean, but obviously I didn't say all of this. I had to be like in strong mama bear mode. And I, like, listening to her, it just kind of reminded me a lot of myself in first year. Remember I said that was a horrible time? Because that's exactly how I felt. I wouldn't speak at all because people couldn't understand my accent. And these were South African people who made me feel like I didn't belong there, and it was horrible. A lot of the people were white or came from like white schools, so they had white accents. And I know some of you might not know this, but in South Africa we have a race called colored, and that's mixed race. So that's the accent I have, and they weren't a lot. I think there were two colored people in my whole class. So it was difficult for people to understand what I was saying. And then when my student came and told me all of this, I just realized how important representation is, because she saw someone that she could speak to, you know, another woman. And I spoke to my class about feeling left out and excluded and not feeling like you're smart enough or good enough, and how I still struggle with these things. I hope I can get over it someday. Right now, I still feel exactly like that, if not worse, which is why I have the second part saying why to retire, and then okay. And I spoke to her about it, and I hope she feels a lot better. She told me she did, but sometimes people just say that so they don't have to sound like a burden anymore. And if you are watching this talk to my student, you will never be a burden, never. You are a human being and you exist and you deserve to take space. And that's for everyone that feels like that. I should take some of my own advice. So why do I want to retire, right? Because sometimes telling stories are really difficult, and I don't feel like you should get into the mindset of I owe it to myself or I owe it to other people to tell a story, because at what cost? At the cost of your sanity, it's very, very difficult telling stories, especially personal stories. I made some games about like the war in Palestine, depression, being queer, molestation, all of these things, and I thought that like, you know, it's good to speak about these issues that I'm passionate about, but it's really, really difficult, because I'm not just making it as some like side removed project. I actually give a shit about what I'm speaking about. So that goes on to my next point about feeling bad. Making games makes you feel bad sometimes, and people and community don't always make it very easy, because like yesterday I came to a maze and I didn't have a good time at all. I felt like I had no friends. I saw a few of my friends for a little bit, but I still felt like this massive space. Do you ever feel like that? Like you're completely removed from everyone else? And some people, like, I don't drink as well. And everyone seemed happy drinking and just like this whole community. And yeah, it was just really weird. And I went back to my room and I was going to work on my talk, but I just watched some more like Vampire Diaries. that I've already seen a million times. Simon had the sign up saying it's almost time up, so I need to fly through my other slides quickly. But I just want to say that I did have some good times in video games. For instance, I took this picture with Rami Ismail. That was really cool. As you can see, we totally posed together for this. And then one time, Nina Freeman tweeted this. So that was pretty cool. Yeah, that's it, guys. That's all my claim to fame, literally those two pictures. I was speaking about representation as well. I feel like I would feel a lot better if I saw someone like me in games. Maybe if there's anyone like this in games, it would be nice, just so I know I'm not alone. Maybe there are other kids or other people out there who will be watching my talk, and like, you can do it. See, I'm here and I'm doing it. And the last thing that I wanted to speak about is, this is me before games and this is me after games, and it's probably how I'll always be. I don't know if you can tell, but I'm fucking screaming inside. That's my preschool photo. How good is my hair? It looks like a fucking wig, right? Like, I think it's pretty cool. Anyway, this talk, what did it do for me? I guess it made me like honest with a lot more people. Things that I've always been honest with myself about. I don't know if I feel like I'm always retiring from video games, like I'm fucking done after this game. I hate games, never again. And then it's like, oh, I'm gonna make a game about this, what? Yeah. So yeah, I don't know, you probably can relate to that. And that's all I have to say. Please keep an eye out for my game after hours. We're currently working on making it a lot better. And yeah, you can follow me on Twitter if you're into like self-harm. And you can check out my itch page. I think it's payakan.itch.io, something like that. And yeah, just let's all just try and be nice to each other, I guess, and inclusive. Thank you. I think I'm supposed to stand here for questions.
Yes, exactly. Okay. So we have like 5 or 10 minutes for questions or comments. If some of you have some, you can just come here and ask a question. I can maybe start with one. Like, is making game a way somehow to extend your poetry writing? I'm thinking about a game you've made called The Room.
Sorry, I didn't hear what you said.
Oh yeah, of course. Sorry. So, is making game a way to extend your poetry writing somehow? I'm thinking about the game The Room that you have made, which has really felt like poetry, interactive poetry somehow. So
yeah, so I made this game for a game jam called The Room, and because I'm super shit at programming, I just did it in Twine. And it was just a poem, and I think the theme was like a room. I don't know which game jam it was for. I've only done one game jam, so it was that. I wrote a poem about a person that's in a room and how the room takes on like characteristics of a person, because the person doesn't leave their room at all, so the room becomes a sort of friend for them. And at the end of it all, the person kills themselves in that room because it feels like dying with someone that you know and that you love, because you spend all your time in the room, so you know that person knows you, kind of thing. And yeah, so that was a poem that I turned into a Twine game. And I definitely use video games as a way to expand on poetry. I'm really into mixed medium stuff, so.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for coming to my talk so much.
Thank you.